A very good evening, everyone. Welcome again to the Hindu News Analysis by the Shankar IAS Academy for the date 3rd of April 2021. These are the list of articles discussed today. The video is time-stamped for your convenience. Check the description box below. So let's move on to the article. Now let us take up this editorial article, which was written by Professor of Epidemiology from the University of Toronto. We all know that the second wave of COVID-19 pandemic is around the corner. So in this context, the author talks about the challenges faced by India in fighting this second wave and also suggests some way forward. So let us look at it in detail. Here is the syllabus for your reference. See, the author is of the opinion that epidemiology of COVID-19 is poorly understood. See, what is epidemiology? Epidemiology means the scientific study of the spread and control of the disease. Basically, the nature of disease in terms of spread is being studied. So without understanding the epidemiology, it is difficult to fight any disease of scale. Now, what does the author has to tell in this regard? Firstly, the author notes that the current surge in the COVID-19 pandemic worldwide is probably driven by variants from the original virus strain. See, here we should know that all the viruses, including SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19, evolves over time. When a virus replicates or makes copies of itself, it sometimes changes a little bit, which is a normal evolutionary process. And these changes are called mutations. And one of our previous analysis, we also saw about mutations, if you remember. A virus with one or more new mutations is referred to as variant of the original virus. Here, the author notes that the evolutionary theory would expect the virus to mutate to become more transmissible. And that is what is evident from the current surge. But with this evolution, there is also an expected associated decrease in the lethality of the virus. Here, lethality means the capacity of the virus to cause death or some serious harm or damage to the human or probably any host. But according to the author, this lethality is not yet properly documented in case of the variants. And for this, direct evidence is needed from genetic sequencing of the virus. So what is genetic sequencing or genome sequencing? See, genome sequencing is nothing but figuring out the order of DNA nucleotides or bases in a genome. That means to figure out the order of adenine, cytosine, guanine and thymine, commonly called as ATGC, that takes up the organism's DNA. And know that virus genome sequencing is vital in the diagnosing of COVID-19 and in understanding the spread and the control of the virus. Secondly, the author talks about herd immunity. So there was a buzz that India had achieved herd immunity towards COVID-19. Here, herd immunity means the indirect protection from the contagious infectious diseases that happens when population is immune. See, the immunity could be either through vaccination or immunity developed through previous infection. That is natural immunity. This means that even people who are not vaccinated or in whom the vaccine doesn't trigger immunity are protected because people around them who are immune can act as buffers between them and the infected people. And various sero surveys have consistently found that half or more of tested urban populations have antibodies to the virus. But according to the author, the current high level of infection runs a different story regarding herd immunity. So this suggests that for largely unknown reason, viral transmission is either cyclical or the half-life of antibodies could be short. Thirdly, the author notes that much of the infection in India might be mild with less durable immune protection than induced by vaccination. That is the half-life of antibody that we just saw. Here, he notes that asymptomatic infection is more commonly reported in the Indian sero surveys. See, asymptomatic means no symptoms are shown whatsoever. That is no fever, no cough, no breathlessness, etc. And this was reported in more than 90% of the cases in sero surveys conducted in India. This is also in contrast to high-income countries where about 1/3 of the infection were symptomatic. So, this milder infection trend among the Indian population correlates with lower severity of clinical illness. And this helps us to explain why there is a widespread transmission but with lower mortality rates. Now let us see what the author suggests so that India can effectively fight the second wave of COVID-19 pandemic. He tells that India needs to increase the quantity, quality and the public availability of the data, the actual data, to guide decision making. Here, better understanding of unique patterns of Indian viral transmission is vital, and it has few verticals which should be achieved. Let's see them one by one. Firstly, collection of anonymized demographic and risk details on all positive cases on a central website in each state should be made a priority. Data collection is what he is meaning for every state. Secondly, the sequencing capacity in the Indian academic and the commercial laboratories should be ramped up to expand the genome sequencing. So first he talks about data, and secondly he talks about genome sequencing, that is analyzing the genomes. Thirdly, far better reporting of COVID-19 deaths is needed. So this will paint a picture on the severity of the COVID-19 disease in India. And fourthly, larger and better set of serial sero surveys should be conducted in addition to the ICMR's National Sero Survey. So this will again expand the research on the already infected people. And finally, researches should be done to better understand why some population are not affected. See, for example, the interesting example of Thailand and Vietnam. COVID-19 infection and death levels in Thailand and Vietnam are remarkably low, even though these countries do not have a very strong testing and tracing programs. So in this regard, comparative studies across parts of India as well as Asia should be done to better understand the disease. Now, this said, the most important part is the action. So foremost is effective vaccination strategies should be made by the government. And secondly, parity in vaccine distribution should also be ensured. That is, the poorer and less educated Indians should not be left behind. That is, inclusive drive is what the author means. Thirdly, follow-up studies among the vaccinated should be ensured. This can improve the durability of protection and reduce the transmission rates. And the vaccine working can also be better understood. And fourthly, central government should launch a national adult vaccination program similar to our universal childhood vaccination program. Here the author notes that the vaccines for 1 billion adults per year might save about 2 lakh lives from being targeted by the disease. Thus, adult and child vaccination programs are an integral part to fight the pandemic. So that brings us to the end of discussion on this editorial. As you can see, this is a 360-degree article on the trend of the ongoing pandemic. Look at this news article. This news article is about the recently announced National Policy for Rare Diseases 2021. Let us understand first as what is a rare disease. According to WHO, rare disease is an often debilitating lifelong disease or disorder, and it has a prevalence of 1 or less than 1 per 1,000 of a population. But there is no universal or standard definition of rare disease, and different countries have their own definitions to suit their specific requirements, especially in terms of prevalence. However, since its prevalence data is not available in India, there is no comprehensive definition for rare disease in India as well. For this purpose, the 2021 policy has interpreted certain groups of disorders to be termed as rare disease. So under the policy, rare disease are categorized into 3 groups. Let's go over it one by one. First is disorders amenable to one-time curative treatment. That is, once treated, patient is cured. Second is disease requiring long-time or lifelong treatment, and the treatment cost but is relatively very low, and the benefits of the treatment have also been well documented. The next group of disease is where the definitive treatment is available, but there are challenges in making optimal patient selection for the benefit, and the cost is also very high. Now, there are many challenges associated with rare diseases. We have given it here for your reference. So, as you can see, most of the challenges stem because of the rare nature of the diseases. So, as we can see, the first one is field of rare disease is complex and it is still very nascent, and not many people know that, and there is no specific medical literature to support the rare diseases. And the researches into the rare diseases is also very less common, and there are also practical difficulties in the researches. And there are also varying definitions and terminologies related to rare diseases, making the understanding of the disease very difficult. And there is also challenge in early diagnosis of the rare diseases, and inadequate knowledge, diagnostic facilities and time-consuming diagnostic processes. These are some of the other challenges. And apart from that, there is lack of awareness, both among the healthcare workers and the general public. So either there is a delay in approaching the medical facility or there is a delay in diagnosis itself. And there is unavailability of the safe treatment. And even when the treatments are available, sometimes they are very expensive. So to overcome these challenges, the policy has been framed. Its main objective is to lower the incidence and the prevalence of rare diseases. It aims to do this based on an integrated and a comprehensive preventive strategy. The strategy encompasses first awareness generations, that is both among the public and the healthcare workers. Next is premarital, postmarital, preconception, postconception, screening and counseling programs to prevent births of children with rare diseases. So let's not forget that most of the diseases are congenital and genetic in nature. And enabling access to affordable health care to patients of rare diseases which are amenable to one-time treatment or which have relatively low-cost therapy, that is the first and the second group treatment. Now let us see important policy initiatives. First is government will notify some selected centers of excellence, which will be the premier government tertiary hospitals, which will have the facility for diagnosis, prevention, treatment of the rare diseases. Currently, these are the center of excellences that are notified. Second, Nidhan Kendras will be performing screening, genetic testing, counseling for rare diseases. So this is the first step. See, the Nidhan Kendras have been set up by Department of Biotechnology under its unique methods of management and treatment of inherited disorders, that is UMMID project, for genetic testing and counseling services. Third is Government of India's support in treatment. The Government of India will provide financial support of up to Rs. 20 lakh under the umbrella scheme Rashtriya Arogya Nidhi. This is for the treatment of group 1 diseases. Here note that already under the umbrella scheme, about 15 lakh financial assistance is provided to patients of group 1 rare diseases for treatment in government hospitals. And the beneficiaries were those belonging to families of BPL. But the 2021 policy envisages to extend the beneficiaries to about 40% of the population who are eligible as per Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. Now for group 2 rare diseases under the policy, state governments have been asked to consider supporting such patients. In addition to these, policy envisages voluntary crowdfunding for treatment. It is for enabling funding by individual donors or corporate donors who are willing to support treatment. This is mainly for group 3 disease or disorders. But this policy, as you can see, has been criticized for two main reasons. First of all, 20 lakhs is a very meager amount and it is not enough to cater to the treatment of these kind of diseases. And secondly, the government support is not provided for group 3 disorders as they are the ones that require sustainable and lifelong treatment. So, but nevertheless, let us not forget that this policy is the first step in addressing those health conditions that were not even recognized as diseases. So let us hope that government will rectify the shortcomings to make the policy more comprehensive. Now look at this news article about the revision of Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act wages, that is MNREGA wages. It says that the daily wages under the act have been revised to ₹289 in Karnataka. So throughout this article, we'll be referring Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act as MNREGA. So in this slide, let us see about MNREGA and also on its wages. Pay attention to the words that is being used in the next few minutes. So MNREGA is the largest work guarantee program in the world and which was enacted in 2005. It aims at addressing causes of chronic poverty through the works that is being given to people. So it gives a legal right to work for a person from a rural area. See, MNREGA is a demand-driven wage employment scheme. It envisages for providing about 100 days of guaranteed wage employment in a financial year to each household in rural area whose adult members volunteers to do unskilled manual work. In addition to this, there is a provision for additional 50 days of unskilled wage employment in one financial year if at all drought or natural calamity notified under the rural areas occurs. Know that Section 3-4 of Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2005 allows the state government to make provisions for providing additional days beyond the period guaranteed under the act. But it has to be done from state's own finances. the central government won't be funding for the additional days. Remember, the act is implemented by Ministry of Rural Development. So once a household registers to the scheme, job cards will be issued and the worker has got the right to demand and receive work within 15 days of the receipt of the application. Remember, the act came into force on Feb 2006 and it covers all the rural districts across India. Now coming to wages. The Employment Guarantee Act gives the central government two options for determining the MNREGA wage rate. The first is MNREGA workers are paid the state minimum wage for agricultural laborers. The second is that the central government notifies separate wage rates for MNREGA. Till about 2008, MNREGA wages were fixed as per the first option and later the second option has been switched to. See, the wages are paid according to state minimum wage rate that is notified under Minimum Wage Act of 1948. In situations where the state government fails to provide employment to worker, then it should pay about 25% of the minimum wage for the first 30 days. So this is as a compensatory daily unemployment allowance. After that, 0.5% of the wage for the remaining period of the year. So it indirectly penalizes the state for failing to provide employment for those registered under MNREGA. So it is to be noted that the scheme provides equal payment for men and women, that is gender parity in wages. And also 1/3 beneficiaries should compulsorily be women. So some other key features of the schemes are as follows. First is time-bound guarantees of work and unemployment allowance and decentralized planning. That is the Gram Sabha will plan the projects that is to be executed under MNREGA. Worksite facilities, especially for the women who are employed under MNREGA. Transparency and accountability, which has been very much extolled about this act. That is, the act provides for social audit. That is, people themselves audit the accounts of the MNREGA. And management information system is a novelty under MNREGA. That is, the details of work, those employed, the muster rolls and the wages paid are all available online. Apart from that, funding. So when you take funding, it is shared between the center and the state. It is done on the basis of three major items of expenditures, including wages, material and the administrative costs. So that brings us to the end of the discussion on MNREGA. Look at this news article. On 1st April analysis, we have said that the IMD predicted continuation of heat waves in several parts of Tamil Nadu. This article says that heat wave gripped several north and interior areas of Tamil Nadu. Many regions recorded temperatures over 40 degrees Celsius even in the month of April. Know that heat wave is a period of abnormally high temperatures more than the normal maximum temperature. In India, heat waves generally develop over northwest India and spread gradually eastwards and southwards. But on some occasions, as in Tamil Nadu's case, heat wave may also develop over any region in situ under the favorable conditions. So to understand more about the heat waves, I recommend you to watch the 1st April's analysis. Today, let us discuss in detail about the history of Indian Meteorological Department, which declares heat wave. Meteorology, as we perceive it now, gained its firm scientific foundation in 17th century after the invention of thermometers and the barometer. Later, the British East India Company established several meteorological observatories in India, mainly to understand the Indian climate. Examples are those at Calcutta in 1785 and in Chennai in 1796, or then called Madras, for studying the weather and climate of India. Apart from this, the Asiatic Society of Bengal, founded in 1784 in Calcutta, promoted scientific studies in meteorology in India. In the first half of 19th century, several observatories began functioning, and in 1875, the then government of India established the Indian Meteorological Department. Initially, its headquarters was in Calcutta and it was later shifted to Shimla, then to Pune, and finally, at present, the headquarters is in New Delhi. And IMD is under Ministry of Earth Sciences. Now, IMD is the National Meteorological Survey of the country and the principal government agency in all matters relating to meteorology and allied subjects. And IMD is headed by Director General of Meteorology. And there are 6 regional meteorological centers across India. And we know headquarters is at New Delhi. The World Meteorological Organization, a specialized agency of United Nations, has recognized Pune Indian Meteorological Department as a regional climate center. So World Meteorological Organization has its headquarters in Geneva, Swiss. So WMO regional climate centers are those centers of excellence that create regional products, including long-range forecasts that supports the regional and the national climate activities. Simply put, the regional climate centers are specific centers that provide regional climate information to the WMO. So IMD's prime mandate is to take meteorological observations and to provide current climate conditions and the forecasted climate conditions to people, which can be used for weather-sensitive activities like agriculture, fishing and irrigation, shipping, aviation, etc. Now, have a look at the image to understand its complete mandate. So that brings us to the end of the discussion on IMD. Now, look at this editorial article. This editorial is written based on the inflation target that is fixed to be 4% for the quinquennium ending 31st of March 2026. So what is quinquennium? It is a period of just 5 years. So in this light, let's see about RBI's report on inflation targeting, Monetary Policy Committee, and also some other important points from the editorial. So here is the syllabus for your reference, students. Before getting into decoding the editorial, we'll first understand some basic concepts that are being utilized in the article. So first is inflation. See, inflation in simple terms refers to the rise in the average price of the goods and services for a longer duration in the economy. And due to the increase in the price, the purchasing power of the money will get reduced over a period of time. That is, we need to spend more than before to enjoy a set of goods or services. And we'll have very less money left over to spend on anything else. So, purchasing power of an individual is affected by inflation. This inflation is measured by indices like consumer price index, wholesale price index, producer price index, etc. And in India, consumer price index is the retail price index commonly taken into account for policy formulation. So next comes inflation targeting. See, it is a monetary policy strategy which is used by the central banks like RBI for maintaining inflation at certain minimum level or within a specific range. That is, policies are made to maintain certain levels of inflation. We know that the primary objective of monetary policy is to maintain price stability. That is, prices should not shoot up too high or too low. Very high prices means people will not consume. Very low prices means businesses may run into loss. And this is done by raising or lowering the interest rates based on above target or below target inflation. Usually, the central banks follow a policy of keeping inflation sufficiently low. On talking about inflation targeting in India, the amendment of the Reserve Bank of India Act in 2016 provided for inflation targeting, and this was to be done by Government of India in consultation with the Reserve Bank. So remember this, students, this was to be done by Government of India in consultation with the RBI once in 5 years. Remember, through the Government of India sets the framework in India, it will be the RBI which operates the monetary policy framework in the country. And the Monetary Policy Committee was constituted by the central government under Section 45ZB of Reserve Bank of India Act 1934. Its mission is to fix the benchmark policy interest rates to restrain inflation within the particular target level. So as you can see, this is our prime structure to achieve inflation targeting in the country. This is done to bring more transparency and accountability in fixing the monetary policy of India. And the Reserve Bank's Monetary Policy Department assists the Monetary Policy Committee in formulating the monetary policy. So what is the structure of MPC? The Monetary Policy Committee consists of three external members, that is government appointed members, and three members from the RBI itself. So the RBI governor heads the MPC and one of the deputy governors will be in charge of the monetary policy. On coming back to the news article, this framework is said to have brought an end to the speculation about the interest rate decisions for the next 5 years, that is from April 1st. Often you would have seen about the inflation interest rates being linked and frequently referenced in the macroeconomics parlance. So we know that inflation refers to the rate at which the prices for goods and services rise. And the interest rate is the amount charged by the lender to the borrower, that is banks and the people. Banks are the lenders and borrowers are the people. See, they both are inversely correlated. That is, when the interest rates are reduced, more people are able to borrow, and this results in the consumers having more money to spend. And this causes the economy to grow and inflation to increase. On the contrary, if the interest rates are increased, the consumers tend to save because returns from the savings are higher. So less disposable money is there with the people and the economy slows and inflation decreases. So in order to make the people spend more, that is to increase the consumption, the government reduces the interest rates to put more money in the hands of people. This is called expansionary monetary policy. For that, RBI cuts the repo rate. So this carries the risk of pushing up the inflation. On the other hand, to bring the inflation down, government will raise the interest rate. This will reduce the purchasing power of the consumer. So the prices will also come down. This is contractionary monetary policy. So this news article basically praises the government decision to keep the inflation targeting as a compass to monetary policy. The government is also retaining the previous levels of inflation targeting. The threshold inflation above which the growth is impaired ranges between 5 to 6% in India. This indicates that inflation rate of 6% and below is an appropriate upper tolerance limit for the inflation target. On the other hand, a lower bound of below 2% is found to hamper growth, thereby leading inflation to dip below the tolerance band. This is what the article calls as deflationary bias. That is, very low price levels that will not benefit the businesses, leading to lower economic activity, which in turn will affect the growth in the long run. Therefore, inflation rate of 2% is said to be the appropriate lower tolerance bound. Based on this observation, it is highlighted that the current numerical framework for defining price stability, that is the inflation target of 4% with plus or minus 2% tolerance band, is appropriate for the next 5 years. Note that the same parameters prevailed in the last 5 years that ended on March 31st. As we can see, there is a range of threshold. This is called as flexible inflation targeting, giving room for prevailing externalities. So to conclude, this measure of maintaining the same inflation levels is seen to be an apt decision, especially at the current scenario, because the inflation pressures are already increasing and the economy is struggling to regain its footing from the contraction phase due to pandemic and the restrictions. That brings us to the end of this discussion. Government asks PSU refineries to review Saudi oil deals. Recently, Saudi Arabia's decision to restrain oil supply to stabilize or increase prices has seriously affected the oil importing countries such as India. West Asia accounts for about 60% of oil brought by India. Latin America and Africa are the other suppliers for India. So in the recent past, India has repeatedly called OPEC countries led by Saudi Arabia to pump more crude oil to stop prices from rising too high. But their decision to hold oil output is forcing India to speed up plans to diversify its crude sources. With the rising tensions with Saudi Arabia over this issue, India has asked its state refineries to review contracts for buying crude oil and negotiate more favorable terms. In this context, let us discuss in detail about India's oil dependency and the import points in the news article. Here is the syllabus for your reference. First of all, let us understand about India's oil consumption pattern and her oil reserves. So know that India's consumption of petroleum products in the year 2018-19 was 213.2 million metric tons. The import dependency on oil based on consumption of petroleum products during the year 2018-19 was about 83.8%, about 84-85%. That is, India imported about 84% of the oil it consumed. That's a huge percentage. Here we must be aware of Indian Strategic Petroleum Reserves Limited. It is a Government of India special purpose vehicle. It has established a strategic petroleum reserves facility with a total capacity of 5.33 million metric tons at three locations. So what are the locations? First is Vizag, Mangaluru and Padur. So what is this reserve exactly? It stores oil for emergency consumption in case the oil supplies are cut off due to some kind of emergency. It is mandated for every International Energy Agency country that 90 days of reserves be managed. But India is not a full-time member, it is only an associate member of International Energy Agency since 2017. This is just an additional information for you. Coming back to the article, as per the consumption pattern of 2017-18, this total capacity from the established three reserves is estimated to provide for about 9.5 days of crude oil requirement. And apart from this, oil marketing companies have a stock for 64.5 days. So the total capacity is about 74 days. Yeah, so this is all for ensuring energy security. What is this energy security that is being discussed? Energy security is keeping India's energy requirements at surplus. So, energy secure India will not face any dearth of energy supply. So, in the current context, most of India's energy comes from oil. So, India is trying to keep reserves of oil. And apart from that, India is also trying to diversify the source of energy like solar, wind, etc. So, coming back to the article, to ensure energy security, government has given in-principle approval for establishing two additional strategic petroleum reserve facilities with a total storage capacity of 6.5 MMT. At two locations. They are 4 MMT facility at Chandikol in Odisha and a new 2.5 MMT at Padur in Karnataka. As per the consumption pattern of 2017-18, this is 6.5 MMT strategic petroleum reserve capacity and it is estimated to provide for additional 11.5 days for India's crude oil requirement. Now let us discuss in brief about India-Saudi economic and commercial relations. Know that India and Saudi Arabia share centuries-old economic and cultural ties. Economic ties constitute a keynote aspect of bilateral strategic partnership. The Delhi Declaration that was signed in 2006 and the Riyadh Declaration that was signed in 2010 emphasized on energy cooperation between the two friendly countries. The importance of Riyadh Declaration is that it is committed to the two sides for a strategic partnership based on complementarity and interdependence. This includes meeting India's crude oil supplies also and identifying and implementing specific projects in the area of new and renewable energy. So coming to trade, Saudi Arabia is India's fourth largest partner after China, US and UAE. The major source of energy as India imports about 18% of its crude oil requirements and 30% of its LPG requirements from Saudi. In financial year 2019-20, bilateral trade was valued at $34 billion, with India's imports reaching $26.84 billion US dollars and exports reaching $6.25 billion US dollars. So you can see that India does not enjoy a favorable balance of trade largely because of crude oil import. Have a look at the image to understand the trade trend over the 5 years. So coming back to the article, it says that India imports 85% of its oil needs and is often vulnerable to the global supply and price shocks. So this is why Center has asked companies such as IOC, BPCL, HPCL to look for supplies from outside the region and use collective bargaining power to get a favorable term for India. Let us not mishear that there are other countries outside OPEC which can sell oil to India also. And India itself is trying to diversify its energy source. And the dependence of oil is rapidly coming down. So let us hope that Indian firms will be collectively able to pressurize the OPEC countries to develop a buyer-friendly mechanism in the coming days. So in this article, we discussed about India's oil dependence, India's move to diversify its sources, and the countries and strategic petroleum reserve. So, let us move on to the last segment of the analysis today, practice questions. The first question, in order to ensure energy security, the Indian Strategic Petroleum Reserve Limited has established strategic petroleum reserves in India. At present, which of the following locations have SPRs? So, these are the given options. And Indian Strategic Petroleum Reserve Limited, a Government of India special purpose vehicle, established the strategic petroleum reserves at three locations we saw in the discussion. One is Vizag, another one is Mangaluru, and other one is Padur. And we know SPRs are not present in Kochi and Chennai. So the correct option is A. So consider the following statement about inflation. It measures the average price change in a basket of commodities and services over time. Statement 1 is correct because inflation refers to the price rise on specific goods and services. The opposite is the fall in the prices and which is called as deflation. So we refer here as basket of commodities and these basket of commodities are considered in the inflation index like consumer price index and wholesale price index. In India, we also saw that CPI, the consumer price index, is used as a policy tool for policy formulation regarding inflation. Second statement, high inflation leads to deceleration in economic growth. And statement 2 is also correct because the purchasing power of a currency unit decreases as the commodities and services get more expensive. And this impacts the cost of living in a country. And in due course, the growth is also affected. And the third statement, the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation measures inflation. This is also correct because The CPI and WPI are measured by the Central Statistics Office, which comes under Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. So the correct option will be option D. Next question. Consider the following statements with reference to the National Policy for Rare Disease 2021. First statement, it increases the financial support provided under umbrella scheme of Rashtriya Arogya Nidhi from 15 lakh to 20 lakh. We saw about this in the discussion, so statement 1 is correct. And second statement, diseases or disorders with available definitive treatment involving very high cost and lifelong therapy will be provided financial assistance by the government directly. This statement is incorrect because the financial assistance is provided for treatment of those rare diseases that require one-time treatment, which is group 1 as we saw in the discussion. But the statement talks about group 3 kind of diseases which require a long-term treatment and where the treatment is also very expensive. And these diseases are being left under the mercy of the donors. And we saw this as one of the major criticisms of the scheme. So which of these statements above are correct? The correct answer is option A, which is one only. Next question. Consider the following statements with reference to herd immunity sometimes seen in the news. And the question asks, which of the above statements is or are incorrect? So first statement, it refers to an indirect protection from contagious infectious disease. And through the discussion, we saw this statement and this statement is correct. And what is the second statement? It does not help people who are not vaccinated or in whom the vaccine does not trigger immunity. Statement 2 is incorrect. Here we know that even people who are not vaccinated or in whom the vaccine does not trigger immunity are protected because people around them who are immune can act as buffers between them and the infected people. So the correct option will be option B. Consider this question, which among the following is not an objective of MNREGA scheme? So this is a direct question. We all know MNREGA is for employment and poverty alleviation. So option C, that is to ensure food security, is the correct answer. That is, it is not an objective, so that is the correct answer. So that brings us to the end of discussion for today. If you like the video, like, share and subscribe to us. We update the video for you every evening. Stay with us for updates. Good day.